Hello students, let us now look at major painters of Impressionism in this module. We shall be specifically looking at understanding in greater detail the works of Monet and Degas. Claude Monet, 1840 to 1926, born in Paris but raised in the port city of Le Havre, he trained briefly with an academic teacher, but soon established his own studio. The work of Claude Monet, more than any other 19th century artist, embodied the technical principles of Impressionism. He was above all a painter of landscape, who studied light and color with great intensity. Because he painted in the outdoors, he and the Impressionists were sometimes called plein air or the open air painters. Well, we know that plein air painting was not new, but what Monet did with his style is just amazing. He had combined the brilliant light effects observed outdoors with the compositional imagination and the technical skill that he had developed. You remember from the last module that it was his painting Impressions Sunrise that gave this whole movement the name Impressionism. Let us talk about this painting first. Painted in 1873, it was one of his later works. It was painted at the port of Le Havre as he looked out of his window. The painting is quick and sketchy to the modern eye. There is some quality of exotic to it. Look at the glowing sun through the heavy fog casting its shadow in the water, and the boats in the foreground and many more at the back simply shone through the mass. There is a much greater emphasis on capturing the impression of light quickly on water and the atmosphere. We see in Monet, like Impressionists, preoccupied with sky, water and source of light and its reflections. In 1867, he had already painted Terrace at the Centres, a masterpiece in itself. From the 1860s, early in his career, Monet worked with a wide range of colors. A comparison of an early and the late work by Monet illustrates the development of the Impressionist style, which we will come to later. He painted his canvas in the summer of 1867 in a scented dress garden with a view of Honfleur at the horizon. The models were probably Monet's father Adolphe in the background, Monet's cousin Jean Marguerite Legardeur at the garden fence, Dr. Adolphe Legardeur, her father, and perhaps Legardeur's other daughter, Sophie. The woman seated in the foreground with her back to the viewer. By adopting an elevated viewpoint and painting the terrace, sea and sky as three distinct bands of high keyed color, Monet emphasized the flat surface of a canvas. His approach, daring of its time, reflects his admiration for Japanese prints. Look at the small strokes of bright pigments against large areas of flat color, from dark green to yellowy greens, bright red oranges and yellows, smoggy blues and scattering of white suggest the brilliant colors contrast of flowers and foliage in the almost painful glare of the summer sun. The pulse of colors against color fractures the spatial continuum of traditional planarism, as do the fences and flagpoles. Now, let us compare it with another painting about 40 years later. Both pictures reflect Monet's concern with the direct observation of nature, and both are the result of his habit of painting outdoors with nature itself as his model. In the water lily pond, the lake of motion is indicated by the more vertical arrangement of the broken colors, greens, blues, yellows, and purples that make up the water's surface. Monet's method here reflects the way light strikes the eye in petals of color rather than in the relatively sharp focus of the terrace. In the water lily pond, the observer's point of view is the same as in the terrace, but the field of vision is much narrower. The magpie painted in 1869 was one of his more mature works. Look at the single black magpie perched on a gate formed in a wattle fence. As the light of the sun shines upon freshly fallen snow, creating blue shadows, a painting of white on white, snow and sunlight, the brilliance of which would be hard to bear otherwise, is a stunning fast actually. Monet used colored shadows to represent the actual, changing conditions of light and shadow as seen in nature. Sun and shade construct the painting and translate the impalpable part solid, part liquid matter. The impressionist landscape was born 5 years before the first official exhibition, when the movement was given its name. Another early work of his landscape painting is his river scene at the Bennecourt scene. Very interestingly, this might look as village scenery, but when observed carefully, you will see a landing and several buildings on the far bank and other boats on the water, a very crowded scene. Well, you also see a young woman, his future wife, Camille Dancio, in summer, sitting under trees on a river bank, and a small rowboat or river in front of her. What we should be looking at is the intense brightness of colors makes the first impression one of pure sunlight. Monet, while rejecting the painting techniques taught at the academy, has applied flat expanses of pure color directly onto the canvas, unmixed and straight from the tube. He sought to capture the play of light quickly before it changed. Well, I think its high-keyed palette of rapidly applied blues, greens and yellows and forms that evoke a sense of immediacy, but this is masterpiece again. After the outbreak of the Franco-Prussian War, 19 July 1870, Monet and his family took refuge in England in September 1870, where he studied the works of John Constable and Joseph Mallord, William Turner. Both of these landscapes would serve to inspire Monet's innovations in the study of color. He also met Pissarro and their future dealer, Paul Dulent Ruel. When in England, he painted a wonderful picture of the theme. Here, he shows the misty atmosphere of the capital on a spring day, with the Houses of Parliament and Westminster Bridge in the background. They are contrasted with the jetty in the foreground, casting broken shadows on the river and the new foliage of the trees on the embankment to the right. Painted in 1871, look at the wonderful hedge and superb grace on grace. What is remarkable is the hieroglyph of the pyre in the foreground against the building of the Parliament and the Westminster. After returning to Paris, he had painted the sunrise. We may ask one question, that despite so much of political turmoil, why did he not paint anything to the Franco-Prussian War and the Commune? Well, his choice was the landscape painting and not any other genre. But could he has painted the general distress in the city? Well, the Impressionists, including Monet, never painted anything connected to political turmoil. But if you look at this painting, you will see the celebration on the streets, as well as demonstrating nationalist enthusiasm. The celebration of 30th June 1878 was also an opportunity to strengthen the position of the Republican regime, still fragile only a few months after the major confrontations of 1876 to 1877 between its supporters and the conservatives. This painting proposes a distant vision of an urban landscape by a painter who did not mix with the crowd, but observed it from a window. The three colors vibrating in Monet's painting are those of modern France. The Impressionist technique, with its multitude small strokes of color, suggests the animation of the crowd and the wavering of flags. This allowed the American historian Philip Nord to write that it perfectly fits the Republican movement, marking the emergence of a democratic society and its roots in the contemporary France. Paris was of much interest to Monet, as you can see in his paintings, especially the cafe and boulevards. The nearby countryside easily accessible by the railroad. In fact, he always traveled to Paris from a nearby suburb. Early in 1877, with help from his friend Gustave Callebaut, Claude Monet rented an apartment in the nearby Romancy and began the first of 12 canvases showing this icon of modernity. Look at the painting where he has created the great modern steel and glass structure, but with the train steam and smoke, like indoor clouds, he hides those huge structures. Apparently, he arranged to have the standing locomotives stocked with extra coal so that he could observe and paint the effects of belching steam. Dull grey when trapped inside the station. White and cloud-like when seen against the sky. The questions that Monet puts in our heads are, how do steam clouds pervade the air? How does a glass and iron roof filter sunlight? How do individuals disappear in a crowd? Well, we can keep thinking about it. But what is clear is that quintessential painter of landscape evoked the controlled chaos of the urban environment and of modernity itself. The above painting was a part of a series. However, Monet did not conceive of it as a series. But after having linked the concept of series, he turned to making another series of 250 paintings on water lilies, depicting Monet's flower garden at the Giverny, and were the main focus of Monet's artistic production during the last 30 years of his life. Now, across many museums all over the world, we have already seen one of his paintings on water lilies at the beginning of the module. Let us look at the ones displayed at the Musée d'Orangerie, illuminating the horizon and the sky. Monet focused on a small area of pond seen as a piece of nature, almost a closure. No details stand out, and the overall impression is one of the shapeless surface. The sky is always shown as reflection in the water. The square format reinforces the neutrality of the composition. The lake of frame of reference gives the fragment an infinite, limitless feeling. Though Monet painted these paintings from a boat in a pond, surrounded by land, in the museum display, it looks as if the water lilies are surrounding us, inverting the whole notion of experience. Let us look at some more of his works. Let us now discuss Edgar Degas. Degas described himself as the classical painter of modern life. He is regarded as one of the founders of Impressionism, although he rejected the term and preferred to be called a realist. Like the Impressionist, he sought to capture fleeting moments in the flow of modern life. Yet he showed little interest in painting plein air landscapes, favoring scenes in theaters and cafes illuminated by artificial light, which he used to clarify the contours of his figures, adhering to his academic training. A superb draftsman, he is especially identified with the subject of the dance, and over half his works depict dancers. His family was upper middle class, bankers with international connection and aristocratic aspirations. He had a very comfortable and a privileged childhood. By 18, he had turned a room in his home into an artist studio and had begun making copies in the Louvre in July 1856. Degas traveled to Italy and remained there for 3 years. His first important painting came in Florence, the Bellini family of his father's sister and her family. This is the picture of not too happy family in the grandeur of a large-scale history painting. His aunt Laura looks miserable. In fact, at this time, her father had also died, immortalized in the red chalk drawing in the wall. The distance between husband and wife is also seen here, as the daughters and the dog brings some movement and fresh air in the moment. He was never interested in landscapes, but one thing that caught his attention was the horses, and he would spend days and days at the race course to look at the horses. Let us look at his next painting. The contemporary suburb racetrack with its billowing factory chimneys punctuating the skyline is very interesting to me. Look at the growing anticipation in the painting as people gather in the center of the painting, along with the racers and the horses in the background. All are depicted with graphic detail and characteristic control, but he has managed to also generate movement. Look at the silks of riders and lights falling on them. In the 1870s, he began painting the modern life of the city, the racetrack, the music hall, and the opera, often focusing on those working to provide the entertainment rather than on their audience. Let us look at this painting now. Degas did not draw or paint actual dancers in rehearsal. Rather, he hired dancers, often very young balletrettes, to come to his studio to pose for him. In this, you will see that many dancers' poses are uncharacteristic of the actual ballet, but are included to show how the life of a dancer is tiresome, involving tedious hours of work. The composition is set in a ragged space, as if viewed from a box, those to the stage. The abrupt foreshortening is emphasized by the dark scrolls of the double basses that put up from the lower left. Let us look at another one. Notice the lightness of the ballerinas dancing. Contrast with the relaxed gestures of those on the left, waiting to perform. Look at the thin layer of paint, rendered even more transparent with time. Look at the beautiful fabric and rendered movement. Degas was also giving a glimpse of contemporary society of women at work. Of all Degas ballet scenes, this monochrome painting differs radically from the veritable orgy of colors splashed around in his later works. The explanation is to be found, no doubt, in the fact that ballet rehearsal was meant to serve as a model for an engraver. Like he painted ballet dancers, he also painted life in bars and cafes. This is another of his famous painting. Look at the boundaries of the frame, disjointed and dislocated. The zigzag construction of the composition creates a slanted viewpoint, rather like that of a candid photograph. It is as if the photographer had taken the picture without aligning the camera with the space being photographed. The two figures, Ellen Andrin, actress, Marceline Desbottin, a painter, printmaker, and bohemian, are stone. Ellen, like Manet's barmaid, stare fixedly at nothing in particular. The poses and gestures convey psychological isolation and physical inertia. And the obvious escape is in the drink. Talking about dislocations and disjoints, we know that Degas had also observed how 16th century Italian mannerists similarly framed their subjects, sometimes cutting off part of a figure. For example, in a woman seated beside a vase of flowers, the figure is cut off at the right edge of the painting, with part of her left hand just barely visible at the lower right corner. In her subdued attire, she seems almost incidental to the riot of color that makes up the central floral arrangement. Unusual vintage points and asymmetrical framing are a constant or a consistent theme throughout Degas' works. The acrobat Miss Lala caused a sensation when she performed at the Cirque Ferrando in Paris in 1879. Here, she is shown suspended from the rafters of the circus dome by a rope clenched between her teeth. Degas made a painting of her in that pose. The image captures the sense of physical exertion as well as perfect poise, making it look like an angel-like figure, generating the feeling of awe. Degas also painted nude women bathing, washing, and drying themselves. Many critics found these ugly, to which Degas replied, "These women of mine are honest, simple folks. It is almost as if you are looking through keyhole." This is also to say that these were models in a closed studio with an emphasis of physical gestures rather than the mood of an individual woman. You will never see the face. Degas used the pastel to accentuate the unanimity. Elegant and acutely observed poses. Since pastel was a dry medium and could be reworked easily, Degas preferred pastel for its powdery quality, which helps suggest a flicker glance for something elusive. Let us now look at some of his other works.